Okay, thank you very much. Let's move to the next talk. Julien, please. Okay, you can start, please. We don't hear you for some reason. Try to talk now.
Do you hear me now?
Yes.
Yeah, yes.
Yes, okay, great.
All the other, please mute yourself.
Okay. So, hello everyone, welcome to my talk. I am Jolien Malfit and I am a PhD student at the Institute of Astronomy at KU Leuven. And today I will discuss how a companion in an eccentric orbit around an AGB star interacts with the wind particles of this star and in this way affects the global wind morphology. And my results are obtained with smoothed particle hydrodynamic models and are recently published in ANA. So, as you know from the previous talk by Silke, recent observations reveal that the winds of AGB stars contain complex structures such as spirals, arcs, bipolarity, and disks. And many of these structures that make the winds deviate from spherical symmetry are believed to be formed primarily by the interaction of the wind with a companion star or planet. Close binaries are expected to be circularized by the AGB evolutionary stage. But however, a large fraction of post-AGB binaries are found to be highly eccentric. So today, it is an ongoing topic of research to investigate how these systems counteract circularization or become eccentric. And some of the observed AGB wind structures are so complex and asymmetric that we expect that they may be created by a companion in an eccentric orbit around the AGB star. So to find out if this is the case, we take a first step in investigating which kind of structures can be created by eccentric binaries. So to do this, we used 3D simulations with the smoothed particle hydrodynamics code Phantom of an AGB star with a solar mass companion at the same major axis of 6 astronomical units with a varying eccentricity and varying AGB wind velocity. As Silke also already told you, these are purely hydrodynamic models without the inclusion of dust, chemistry, and pulsations. And the cooling is regulated by the equation of state with polytropic index in between the adiabatic and isothermal regime. But in future work, the impact of these aspects will also be studied as they are currently being implemented into Phantom by our colleagues Lionel Sis and Bart Homan at the ULB. So then we use these simulations to investigate in detail how the wind companion interactions in circular and eccentric orbits result in different types of inner wind structures around the companion and AGB star, and how these different inner wind structures on their turn then result in various global morphologies. So the companion shapes the wind morphology by two primary effects. The first one being the induced orbital motion of both stars around the center of mass, and secondly, the gravitational attraction of matter by the companion. And the physical properties of the binary system and of the AGB winds will then determine the relative strength of these effects and the global shape of the outflow. So as Silke showed in the previous talk, a higher value of the classification parameter epsilon results in a more complex wind morphology, since the perturbation by the companion is stronger when its mass is large, the semi-major axis small, and the wind velocity low. So I will now introduce you to the different inner and global wind structures that resulted in our simulations, ranging from the weakest to the strongest wind companion interaction. So in the circular model with the highest wind velocity, and thereby lowest epsilon value and least strong interaction of the companion with wind, an approximate Archimedes spiral density enhancement results in the orbital plane. And the spiral manifests itself in the edge on plane as concentric arcs. But the inner wind structure that creates this global morphology is a broadening spiral structure attached to the companion that is delimited by a dense inner and a less dense outer edge. So as the wind material approaches the companion, their path gets gravitationally deflected. And because the companion is in motion, there is a gravitational slingshot that results in a velocity dispersion in the gas flowing behind the companion. So the material behind the companion with the lowest radial velocity component collides with faster inner wind particles and forms the relatively slow inner edge. But the gas with the highest radial velocity component collides with the outer wind particles and forms the fast outer edge of the spiral. And because of the velocity difference of these edges, the outer edge catches up with the inner edge from the previous revolution. And from this point on, just one spiral structure results that shapes the global morphology. Then we have the same model with a lower wind velocity and thereby an increased gravitational impact of the companion. And this one has again an approximate Archimedes spiral structure in the orbital plane, but now with bicentric rings in the edge-on plane that shape the wind into an elongated peanut shape. The inner structure shaping this morphology is, however, different than in the previous case, as can be seen from this density plot. Instead of a broadening two-edged spiral structure, there is now one dense spiral flow behind the companion and a second spiral that emerges from a bow shock in front of the companion. So there is a strong compression of gas by the companion that results in a dense flow towards the companion. And then delivered by this dense flow, hot gas particles pass by and around the companion with high velocities. And this region of energetic particles then induces a strong pressure gradient in front of the companion. And this pressure gradient then bends the path of AGB particles, AGB wind particles, that are gravitationally deflected towards the companion. And the resulting structure is then called a bow shock. And because the bow shock is stable in this model, irregular spiral results again in the global morphology. But when we lower the wind velocity even more, the absolute value again increases since the wind-companion interaction becomes stronger. And here we see a squared spiral density enhancement with a rose-like edge on view. And this model results in a similar way as the previous one, except that the bow shock is now unstable. And that is because more energetic wind particles are gathered around the companion, such that instabilities arise, and this energetic material starts to escape the companion. And through its radial outward movement, these particles pass by the bow shock and transform it. And this instability is a periodic behavior, but the cause of this periodicity is still unclear. But so specific in this model, energetic material propagates radially outward about 4 times each orbital period. And these 4 directions of these outflows shape the global morphology into the square structure that we see. But then in eccentric systems, the binary separation varies between a maximum value at Apastron and a minimum value at Periastron passage. So the induced variation in the orbital velocity throughout one orbital period makes the stars reside for a longer time at Apastron than at Periastron passage. And this results in a phase-dependent wind-companion interaction intensity, such that more complexities are encountered. But the least complex eccentric system is again the one with the highest wind velocity, so most limited wind-companion interaction. And compared to the circular model with the same input parameters, the edge-on arcs have now become asymmetric ring arc structures, and the orbital plane is perturbed, especially on the upper right side of the orbital plane. More precisely, at the left side, which is the periastron side of the companion, low-density gaps arise. And the points delimiting these low-density gaps are called bifurcations, and these are locations where two structures seem to split up or come together. These aspects were already classified as characteristic patterns of eccentric systems in the literature, but we found that they arise because of the varying phase-dependent inner wind structures. So the wind-companion interaction in these models is strongest around the periastron passage, where the orbital separation is minimal, and this results in the formation of a bow shock after periastron passage. And then around Apastron, the path of the companion changes drastically as the orbital separation starts to decrease again. And this creates an outflow of the energetic material that was located within the pulse shock. And this deforms the upper right part of the orbital plane. And then after Apastron, the wind compression around the companion is limited again because of the large orbital separation. So therefore, a broadening two-edged spiral forms until the companion passes again at Pirastron passage and starts to compress more material around it again. And because of this strong variation in the inner wind structure, these low density gaps and bifurcations arise. But then the most complex systems are the eccentric ones with the strongest wind companion interaction. Their morphology and inner structure are all similar in the sense that their orbital plane structures are irregular. And in the meridional plane, of especially the most extreme cases with the lowest wind velocity, bipolar outflows are formed. So on small scales, we see that the companion is surrounded by an unstable, irregular pole shock. Because of the phase-dependent wind interaction intensity, the region of compressed material around the companion within this pole shock changes in size throughout the orbit. And the instable nature of this pole shock, combined with the eccentricity of the orbit, results in periodic escapes of energetic particles. So on the temperature plot you see here, you see how the hot particles are propagating radially outwards, and in this model, this is to the upper side of the orbital plane. But however, these energetic outflows are three-dimensional features.
2 minutes.
So in the edge-on view, they cause bipolar outflows with velocities up to 35 kilometers per second. And in the pressure and velocity plot, you see how energetic material escapes towards the poles around the companion as an expanding high pressure region in the shape of a butterfly. So these bipolar outflows resemble the ones that form in post-AGP systems, which are believed to be launched through jets that originate from accretion disks. But in our models, these outflows are mainly caused by inefficient cooling around the companion. So in improved models with more accurate cooling, we expect that accretion disks may form and that these energetic outflows might be different or less significant at least. So to conclude, we found that the different inner structures and global morphologies are formed in the wind depending on the strength of the wind companion interaction. And that in the case of eccentric systems, the phase dependency of the varying orbital separation results in a variation of these inner structures, such that asymmetric and irregular global morphologies are formed. But if you are interested in the details of this work, please take a look at our paper. So thank you for listening. Do you have any questions?
Okay, Laura, is your hand from the previous talk or from this talk?
No, it's from this talk.
Okay, please go ahead.
Yeah, thank you. A very nice talk. I really liked it. I just have one question. The orbit is not evolving, right? You're imposing that the orbit is in a particular eccentricity, right?
It can evolve. It can evolve. I looked at that, but it's same with Silke. We only have 6 orbital periods, so it did evolve a bit, but we couldn't really trust that. Yeah, the evolution, because it's just 5 orbital periods, so it's really small evolutions.
Okay, because I was just wondering if you have you have this closed binary. Wouldn't one expect that is more circular? I mean.
Yeah, that's a thing.
I mean, the maximum eccentricity that you are presenting, it was 0.5, right?
Yes.
But wouldn't one naturally would expect almost a circular orbit? That's my question.
Yeah, that's the thing that we don't really know, because they see it in post-AGP stars. And since we don't know which mechanism is causing these eccentricities there, we think that maybe it may be already there in the AGP phase. So that's also what I would like to study. If the eccentricity is growing because of the mass transfer, maybe. Because I saw in some models that the eccentricity was growing a bit, but since it's only 5 orbital periods, I don't want to trust that, of course. So yeah, we want to investigate that.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Jo, did you want to ask something? If not, Amit, go ahead.
Yes, so can you please explain again what is the difference between the square shape and I think you call it a rose shape? I didn't get the difference exactly?
Yes, the square is in the orbital plane, and the rose is the edge of you, so the meridional plane.
Ah, okay.
These are slices through the three-dimensional morphology.
Thank you.
Is this an eccentric orbit or circular here?
This one is a circular one.
It's a circular and you get the square?
Yeah. Yes, yeah, because of these periodic outflows of materials.
Because of what?
The periodic outflows of material. Because there's material around the companion and then it starts to escape.
Okay. George Chen, please.
So I have a comment. I find when SPH code with a very small outflow velocity, they usually produce something like this irregular shape or chaotic shape. But sometimes I think it's from the boundary condition, because your velocity, your wind outflow velocity is 5 kilometers per second, and it's barely subsonic. It's usually subsonic at the place of your boundary. And you are, you have boundary issues, usually.
You mean the at the companion boundary issues?
No, the outflowing gas, the donor star, yeah. So the outflow velocity is too small, and
it gets accelerated a bit. That's the initial one, but it goes to 10 kilometers per second, but yeah, it could be.
I mean this one, okay, that's one comment.
I'll think so.
What you say that the square in the center reflects the square of the grid?
No, it's not a grid based code, so it's just free SPH particles, so it's not because of the grid.
You had another comment? No. Says, okay. So I have a question. Can you please repeat, how do you accelerate the polar outflow, which is quite slow, 30 kilometers per second? So it's not the 100 or 300 kilometers per second that we call bipolar outflow. But still, it is interesting. Can you repeat, how do you collimate it here?
Yes, so it's all those weird things are actually the same mechanism, that there is a large accumulation of particles around the companion star, and you get, those particles become very energetic, and it's like the companion cannot handle all of them, so they start to escape in various regions. And in this case, so in these models, if you look at the edge on view, so this is what you see here, so you look at the stars like this, then that material starts to escape at the poles because there is the lowest density. So
you have the gravity of the companion, and it accumulates mass. Do you get an accretion disk like the previous talk today mentioned?
No, and it is because the cooling is inefficient because we don't have very realistic cooling, so it's way too hot there for an accretion disk to be able to form.
Okay.
So we expect that these outflows will be less significant if we have better cooling.
Okay, very good. If there are no more comments, we'll move to the last talk. Okay, please, Eva.
Thank you
very much.